well, for long-term research by the National Science Foundation. And she develops interactions with state and local groups involved in mine drainage and watershed issues in the Rocky Mountains. So please join me in welcoming Diane.
Well, first, I greatly appreciate the opportunity to be here and talk to you about our research in Antarctica, the support we have had from UNAVCO for the McMurdo Dry Valleys LTR project has just been fundamental to our success and a great contribution. And the Antarctic environment is always challenging, whatever you try to do, and the more technical you try to be, it just gets more challenging. So again, hats off to UNAVCO. As Megan mentioned, the McMurdo LTR '93, when we made an arrangement with New Zealand research program to continue the flow record for the Onyx River. And you will see why we consider that to be the start date season as a team in the field. This is a picture of Wharton Creek, the first lead principal investigator of the McMurdo Dry Valleys project, who was at the Desert Research Institute. He passed away about a year and 4 months ago, and on to become the president of the South Dakota School of Mines and Technology. That just gives you a sense of how technical we were, and a great leader in terms of academic research. Named after him, and this is, let me back up. So I have University of Colorado, and for those of you who've been to the Antarctic, this is our event number, B506M, which is otherwise known as the Stream Team. The McMurdo Dry Valleys LTR project, and over the years, we have focused on the linkages among ecosystem components, and I'll try to explain what we mean by ecosystem components in a second. So in the Dry Valleys, it's glaciers, soils, streams, and lakes. And this research is carried out by a combination of lead investigators, postdoctoral fellows, research associates who bring a lot of continuity and expertise, collaborators, and students. Many people, I'd like to go to Antarctica. I said, well, my students go to Antarctica and they get master's or PhDs in civil or environmental engineering, and that's a filter. there are, have that picture of Taylor Valley. It's the valley where we do most of our field research. Out here is McMurdo Sound. These are alpine glaciers. We're looking at the Kukri Hills. And we initially tried to conceptualize our project by showing how ecosystem and change was at the center of all these disciplines, hydrology, biology, meteorology, and chemistry. And that's a larger overview, but many of the ecological research sites are about that. What makes us, and so what I want to do now is explain how we fit in a larger sense within this LTR network. So there are 25 long-term ecological research sites. The Niwot Ridge site has been going since 1980, was one of the first of six, and the Colorado Rocky Mountains. 22 Antarctica is the Palmer TR. I'm sure there's some UNAVCO connections out there, maybe. 16 are terrestrial sites. There's two urban sites. Baltimore and 6 are LTER sites. And so we can think of these sites as representing many different gradients, certainly. The Dry Valleys is at the end in terms of human impact, we might have the Dry Valleys and Baltimore at one end. Look at average annual temperature versus the average annual precipitation. Here's the McMurdo Dry Valleys right there, and this is the Luquillo Forest in Puerto Rico. And some of you may have worked there. So this idea of the LTR network is to understand, develop ecosystem understanding that goes beyond one place and where ideas come forward through long-term observations that are relevant in different environments and builds the ecosystem science. So it's definitely overcome the dominant way of thinking maybe 40 years ago that my backyard is like this, so the rest of the world must be like this. And as more scientists have come up with the have been trained while the LTR network existed, ecologists and other people just think, well, of course there would be a network. Of course you would have this. Almost for granted. So the McMurdo Dry Valleys are here on the edge of McMurdo Sound. The Trans-Antarctic Mountains are buried by ice, and these Trans-Antarctic Mountains are responsible for blocking the flow of the ice sheet out to the coast. So these dry valleys are dry because the ablation loss of ice is greater and the land is exposed. And this land has probably been exposed for 12 million years or that time frame, quite a long time. Which is part of LTER Schoolyard book series. This was published as part of the International Polar Year, which you may have been involved in 2007, 2009. The first book in the school before was published by the Niwot Ridge Long-Term Ecological Research Project, and it's called My Water Comes from the Mountains. And I just, the series has now expanded to include another 7 books, Florida Everglades, Morea, one for the Tahiti is in press now. And I just got the statistics of the Boulder Valley School District that this book and the curriculum that we developed to go with that, which we provided these kids to the Boulder Valley School District in 2006, and it's tailored towards the water topic that's for fifth graders, according to the standards. We just found out that every year, 30% to 40% of the fifth graders in are being trained using this curriculum that goes with it. So I thought I'd mention that in terms of if you're thinking about outreach, there's some well-trained fifth graders about hydrology here in Boulder, and we take about of the idea that kids forward. So all of these are intended to work as helping children to understand their schoolyard at the area near them to develop environmental empathy and not so much emphasizing the disasters of climate change that lay ahead or whatever. Of the Antarctic, who are the schoolyard for Antarctica? What we built upon was the fact that kids all over the world are, for whatever reason, fascinated by Antarctica. And has artwork in the book contributed by kids from US, Britain, Australia, and New Zealand. Drive out. We have. Here's some summary information. It's air temperature can be quite cold. The degree days above freezing are limited. The soil and surface temperatures, the absolute maximum can be pretty warm. And the precipitation is very high. And stream flow can vary from lots to none of. And so that's one of the things I'm talking about. In the ecosystem. So here's a way of conceptualizing landscapes. We have lakes. These lakes are permanently ice-covered so far. The river can range from 5 to 3.5 meters, 7 meters sometimes. The streams, which only flow for 6 to 12 weeks per year, are responsible for the lakes filling up. Extensive area of soil. And then the glaciers are also ecosystems, and that we have what are called cryoconite poles on the glacier surface where sediment accumulates in depressions and then occurring in these cryoconite holes. And then when there's high stream flow, there's potential for the organisms in these cryoconite holes then to be washed into the streams and onto the lake. So that's one of the potential biological connectivities in addition to the hydrologic connectivities in this ecosystem. So when we first got started, Thomas has seen this cartoon a few times. Right. This was our conceptualization of how the dry valleys work, where we have solar radiation, sublimation, snow, and dry deposition. We have meltwater inflow. There's a moat that can open up the ice cover. There's some substantial prediction of microbial growth in the bottom waters. Here's the water column. And then we have very strong winds that are transporting aeolian material and deposition on valleys and stream channels. That was our idea. So what we need to do designing a long-term ecological research effort is to take this concept and translate it into what do we measure and how do we measure it, how frequently. So this is showing Taylor Valley. I'll start with the red dots because I'm in charge of the stream gauges. The red dots are the stream gauges, and we have a network of about 20 streams that we're monitoring using approaches that were the same exactly as the U.S. Geological Survey. And I worked for the USGS for 17 years, so I know that the USGS way is generally the right way. And then we have a network of meter stations shown in green. And these are not just in Taylor Valley, but throughout the dry valleys. And then we have what's called a limno hole, a limnological monitoring station, where there's instrumentation deployed. It's making measurements year-round about temperature and conductivity of the water. And soil observation actually do exist in different periods. And that's what's shown here. I'd like to take an opportunity to point out that seeing these streams, we think of not only the open channel, but in the dry valleys, we can see an area called the hyper, which is where the water is moving in and out of the sediment and a riparian area adjacent to the stream. And you can actually see this as a damp, wetted area on either side of the channel. And that influences the chemistry of the stream significantly, and that's the zone where weather reactions occur. And the streams, see the longer blue lines on this side than that side? So there's about 3 or 4 times more solutes in the water from these longer streams coming from the lake, weathering that happens here. This is where we hang out. This is my favorite hut. I don't know that Thomas would agree with me, but this is what we call the F6 hut, which is on the east end of Lake Frixel. What has been happening is the lake levels have been rising, so right now, the lake has encroached to about this point. This is, I can tell this is an old picture because it's only 2 years old, but the landscape is changing. So getting back to the context of this research site, when Robert Falcon Scott first came to the Taylor Valley, he called it the Valley of the Dead. He said there's no observable life, and he described the mummified seals that were part that could easily be observed if you hike around. They're all over. And the kids' book I mentioned from which these pictures are taken was a description of the first encounter of a living seal in the Dry Valley. If you go to our website, we have video of the seal from this event in 1990, and the seal, you might wonder, how many people want to know what happened to the seal? The seal was came into camp, and then the decision was made that the rules they can act where you can move animals up. Seal was brought back to McMurdo Sound in a sling load under a helicopter, and we have video of that. And I'll tell you, is a hit with fifth graders. And there's a link to that on our website. So moving along, in addition to work in Taylor Valley, we study the Onyx River, which initially was monitored by the New Zealand Antarctic Program, and that's continued. We took over that monitoring in 1992-93, as I mentioned. And this is the longest environmental record in the Dry Valleys. The that I'll show you the data for are the only flow measurements being made on the entire continent. So we think, how many stream gauges are there in North America? A lot. And these are the only flow measurements in the whole continent. So this is what the Onyx River looks like at low flow, flow. The way we determine stream flow is we measure pressure at a point, and this is a weir, so that we develop what's called a ring. Allows us to translate that pressure to depth to discharge meter cubed per second. And then that rating curve is developed based on making discrete measurements going across. Yeah, so when we do this, we're directly observing velocity at a depth, and if it's higher flow, we make velocity measurements at two depths. So this whole protocol for developing this rating curve is based on how the USGS does it, and we've most recently transferred from ADAPS to Aquatic Informatics Aquarius software, which the USGS is in the process of doing right as well, if anybody's interested. So stream flow is important because, as I mentioned, the lakes are rising. The lake level measurements began, I think, in about 1972, also by the New Zealand program, and we have taken that over and maintained lake level measurements. What's been happening in the last 20 years has been, I would say, curiouser and curiouser. And we are trying to figure out as we go what's happening. And we are finding that the ozone hole has been a major driver. So this is the total ozone in Dobson units up at the top. So that began in about 1980. And here is lake level. This is Lake Bonney in Taylor Valley, and these are Lake Hoare and Lake Frixel. Here's the flow record of the Onyx aligned for this period, and these are in 10 to the 6 meter cube per summer. So you know that's the annual flow, but there's no flow in the middle of the winter. So this is the total flow, and you can see in the early 90s, there was some high flows that caused substantial lake level rise, but the lakes have been rising during this period as well. And then we come to this period, and some the flows were generally low. The ozone hole was in force, and the temperatures were lower than before. There had been a cooling trend. Since then, there have been a few summers where the conditions have changed, and there have been high flows. The 2001-2002 higher than the highest flows that we've and we, thanks to the brilliance of atmospheric scientists, including Susan Solomon, why these low flows occur due to cold temperatures. And I'm going to explain this from a hand-waving hydrology point of view. Ozone is itself a greenhouse gas. The absence of ozone retains less heat. So when you have an ozone hole over Antarctica, it's not surprising that it gets colder. The main effect, however, has been to strengthen the polar vortex. So imagine these winds over the Antarctic continent being stronger. This gets back to why is the Antarctic colder than the Arctic? It's because the Antarctic is surrounded by oceans. The landmass radiate heat back through the winter. So the polar vortex winds have been strengthened by the ozone hole so that the summer comes later because that polar vortex isn't breaking up as earlier and it starts off colder. That's my explanation, or that's my description of the elegant science done by atmospheric scientists. These years trying to figure out what's the difference in terms of why this happened has been challenging. I'll talk about that in a bit. So this is what high flow in the Onyx River looks like. And it's a very flashy system because there's no base flow. There's no groundwater flow. The active layer melts out about 50 centimeters, and it's rock hard permafrost below that. So here, the next slide. So this is what November 20th, 2001 looks like before stream flow. See the yellow. There was just maybe starting to be a trickle. And then this is December 26th. So that high flow corresponded to a discharge of 700 cubic feet per second, which is twice Boulder Creek at its maximum. It's still less than Boulder Creek at the flood that we just had, maybe. I could put that in parenthesis context. Anyway, it can all happen very quickly. And if you think about that landscape, there's a lot of ice sitting up there that can melt. So we published a paper in Nature in January 2002, which, you know, these dates line up. And while this paper came out, this is what was happening about the cooling trend. And so what was reported this is the cover of the Antarctic Sun-Times, ice cools as world warms. So this was a very controversial finding, challenging climate change, because Antarctica isn't warming up. Is climate change real? This is, again, January 2002. At the same time as we were publishing this paper, I was on the North America Committee for the Impacts and Vulnerability Working Groups 3 for the IPCC. I was on the North America Committee, so we're talking about failed agriculture, failed wastewater treatment systems getting flooded out, all these problems, and what made the headlines. Did our executive summary and summary for policymakers generate any front page news on the New York Times? No, but this finding did. So here's the Antarctic Sun-Times, ice cools as world warms. And then the other headline is heat wave melts ice flood valleys. So some of the newspapers picked up on this Antarctic sometimes and said, okay, well, it shows we don't quite know what's going on. Well, so as we think about that in terms of how we communicate climate change, we think about this in the context of how ecosystems respond. We can use a framework of a press in terms of a gradual change that maybe had been causing the lakes to rise, this cooling crest due to the ozone hole, and then these pulse events that can happen. And in terms of moving ahead, there's obviously uncertainty if you don't know what the drivers of these pulse events are. And so this is where we're focusing now and trying to understand. And our most recent insight seems to be that it's not temperature, but it's the solar radiation and possibly the persistence of the ozone hole into the summer. But our overarching hypothesis for the research we're doing now is that the ecological response is driven by these changing landscape connectivities between a pulse and a regular summer in terms of movement, biota, and material. The Lake Bonnie Camp being flooded during a pulse event. Here's a precip collector in the lake. And the lake did respond to this pulse event very quickly. This is primary production in one of the lobes. The primary production is how much the algae are growing. You wouldn't think necessarily that this high flow event would suppress algal growth, but it brought in a lot of sediment and made the water less clear so that there was less sunlight for the algae that are already having a hard time growing under 4 meters of ice. So this is the theme of our research. And if we think about the context of streams and the soils, we can think about this as changing hydrologic connectivity in the landscape. Here's a diagram showing the different kinds of invertebrates that are present in the soils. This is a nematode, Scotnema lindsayi, which is the lion of the Dry Valley. It's a predator, and it's named after Robert Falcon Scott, if you're wondering. And we have tardigrades in the stream channels, otherwise known as water bears, these microbial mats in the streams that are a combination of cyanobacteria and diatoms. These mats are freeze-dried all winter, and as soon as the water arrives, the microbial mats will start photosynthesizing within 10 or 15 minutes. So they're very responsive and resilient to change, and again, not only cyanobacteria, but diatoms. And we did this research in an area that we call Worm Herder Creek. It's not officially named yet. The helicopter pilots dubbed the soil scientists as worm herders because they were herding these worms. And so we've named the creek informally after Worm Herder Creek because this creek only flows had flowed three times in the last 20 years. And the soil scientists, when they were setting up their soil experiments that I pointed out, chose what turned out to be Worm Herder Creek as a place to put in some of their long-term soil experiments, not knowing that it was a wetland in the stream. So here's, we have a gradient from Canada Stream that flows year-round to Worm Herder Creek where we observed it. It actually was flowing this season as well, so this is now up to 4. And here's a picture of my colleague, Wall, who's at Colorado State University, and she's a soil scientist, and here she's just collected a sample from a mini piezometer in the middle of Worm Herder Creek when it was flowing to help understand the soil biota. So these kinds of events also foster interdisciplinary research as we as a team. And so here's what we did. And I wanted to highlight this because we used a lot of UNAVCO support. There's LIDAR maps all over here. We recorded the outline using GPS. we collected, characterized the diatom community. I'll talk about that in a little bit. Collected soil samples for chemistry and soil fauna, how that varied, and basically try to understand how soil communities are influenced by soil properties and this time scale of connectivity. And we also did a tracer experiment where we added a tracer up into the, what we thought was the mainspring feeding this wetland to see whether we could detect the chemical tracer. We used lithium and chloride as tracers because these are naturally present and we can add them at a, for a short time at a concentration that's two or threefold above background, and then that's over. So here's the overview. What we found from the tracer experiment is that there's a lot of water coming into the system here, and we added a tracer there, and you can't even tell that you added the tracer by the time you get down to about this point. So there's a large reservoir of water that's interacting, and this is really a worm herder wetland, and the creek is an expression of that wetland. So the soil team put in three transects. 1, 2, 3, and looked at the how the soil fauna were distributed. And this is number of individuals per kilogram of dry soil, the log. But even it's not a lot. There's not a lot of abundance, but it still gives us a way to measure this, and we can identify which types of organisms they are. And you can see the plectus, which is a water-loving nematode, and the rotivers are more abundant in areas where there's water at some point. So the organisms are waiting there for these events to happen. And if we look at diversity, where the larger bubbles are more diversity, we can see how this diversity pattern, both in terms of species and groups, are following the pattern of that wetland. So just visually, you can see that. Let me go through this. And so by thinking about these distributions, we could look at the properties of the soil in terms of electrical conductivity, how salty is the soil, and these are the distribution of these different organisms. And you can see that there's some threshold for soil saltiness that seems to be controlling the distribution, and that the role of this wetland that flows intermittently may be to flush out salt and enhance the suitability of the habitat. So a place like this allows us to go to other soil environments and make measurements of the soil properties and get a sense of the what's controlling the distribution of those organisms as they change, as there's more melting of the permafrost and frozen zones. So moving along, so that's soil organisms. We can also think about using the diatoms that are present in the dry valleys, both in the mat and the lake, in the streams and in the lake sediments, and understanding what are the relationships between their habitat and the hydrologic scheme, to then use, be able to go back in time to potentially understand other past environments, because the microalgae, terrestrials, are preserved in lake sediments and perch deltas and environments like this. So there are 42 species of diatoms that we found. About half or more are endemic, which means they only occur in either the Antarctic and subantarctic, and some are endemic to South Victoria Land, where we're doing our research. And this is a Ludicola gaussii, and you can use scanning electron microscopy to and light microscopy to tell these apart. What we've found is that there are two genera that seem to have radiated in terms of developing new species evolving in the dry valleys or in South Victoria Land, potentially in response to this variable climate or hydrologic regime of individual streams. So this is the percent abundance of diatoms in a sample we would collect from a stream mat. Do you remember that picture of the stream mat? And we could say, well, how many of those silica frustules are from species of the taxa of the genera Hantia, the genus Hantia, or the genus Ludicola? And so this is Canada Stream, which is a stream at that end of the gradient which flowed all the time because of the glacier. So Hantia and Ludicola taxa are not abundant there. We'll come all the way over here to the mat in Wormherder Creek. I forgot to mention that when the Wormherder Creek turned on, suddenly there were bright orange algal mats. They've been waiting, just like the nematodes, for something to happen. And if we look at the diatoms in those mats, there's mostly Ludicola, and of these, it's a particular taxa of Ludicola that's a rare taxa in all these other streams, and it's maybe 60% of most of the samples in Wormherder Creek. So, and that the Hantia taxa sort of peak in the middle of this gradient of flow frequency, high to low, where we're talking flow frequency on decadal timescales. And these are microorganisms. So, and microorganisms, we think of, they grow on timescales of days, weeks. So this is fascinating to us in terms of these communities. And then, you know, so a Hantia species peak, and then there's Ludicola. And here's an example. Here's the Ludicola dolia that I mentioned. I guess the average is only 20%, but still it's quite dramatic. And this gives us a tool to look at lake sediments and the perch deltas, and by looking at the diatoms that might be there, know what the hydrologic regimes might have been at that place at that time. So what is going to happen? And this sort of teaser about what's controlling stream flow. So since the flood year, which we refer to as this event, it's really not a flood year. It was a flood 3 weeks. But and here is the flow record for the streams flowing into Lake Frickell, where we have 9 streams. And some of those streams are draining high elevation glaciers, and some are draining lower elevation glaciers. So the Canada Stream, which is the red, drains a lower elevation glacier. That's why it always has flow. You know, because of the adiabatic lapse rate, the high elevation glaciers contribute flow when the summers are during warmer summers. So that's what this bar graph represents. And the dashed blue line represents flow season average temperature. So if you average the temperature for the period when Canada Stream is flowing, and look at this. This was 2010. It was cold. We were there. And there was a lot of water. Here it was cold and there was a lot of water. Here it was warm and there wasn't any water. So when you're there for a month or two, you can really experience this, that they're not that coupled. So we were aware, clearly the ocean hole is driving the why it was cold during this cooling trend. Is there a way to think about how the ozone hole persistence might be influencing the hydrology? There's photochemical processes that could be happening on the surface of the ice grains, and this has been studied for the Arctic in terms of snow. But it could potentially be influencing in terms of the transparency of the ice beyond just the radiative input. This is an area of research. So here's 2009-10. We go back here. So here's 2009-10. And this is a graph of total flow for in terms of the percent chance exceedance of the total flow. So this 2009-10 is an average flow year, so that it's right around a 35% chance of exceedance in terms of looking at a flow record. Is everybody with me on this? And that there's this high flow year had only a 5% chance of exceedance if you look at it that way. And the cold years down here are more likely exceeded. Is everybody with me on that? Okay, so there were 0 days of the persistence of the ozone hole over the dry valleys after November 15th. Well, what's special about November 15th? That's when the sun clears the mountains. So you could have full radiation. There's not any shadow. And then here's 2010-11. When it was colder, but there were 13 days of this new unit, an ozone hole day, like a degree day, where we measurements of the Dobson units that we can access. And if we look at this high flow, the rest of this is 13 days for the highest, 9 days, 4 days, and a lot of these down here are zero. So surprisingly enough, when you do a correlation over our entire stream flow record, we have an R squared of 0.31 and an alpha of 0.05 in terms of correlation with ozone hole days. And there's no correlation with summer temperatures. So this is not even hot off the press. We've just submitted it. And we don't know what people are going to say, but this is how, by having observations, you can get surprising results, potentially. And here is an animation. So this you can get from the Ozone Hole Watch NASA website. And the blue is the ozone hole. And this was the low flow season, 2009. And I think see the date here? That's showing all of Antarctica. And we stop there. And the red star is the dry valley. So now let's look at the 2010 season. Everybody ready? So you can get a feel for it. Again, I say we should all be watching this ozone watch so that we would be more motivated to wear sunscreen when we're there. In any event, the other point I want to make is, again, these are the only stream flow records in the entire continent. Deserts. So if this is a driver in the dry valleys, it could be important in terms of Antarctica's contribution to sea level rise. Potential. So getting back to this, think about that, and now I'm going to go back to ecology. One of the things I point out is we're ecologists, hydrologists, we need some brilliant atmospheric scientists and some snow physicists and ice physicists to see why this might be or what else may be going on. So in terms of making trend analysis, where we have the mean annual shortwave radiation, which we monitor, it's pretty much leveled off. And here's the mean air temperature was going down, and it stopped going down if you draw a line through that. And now if we see the number of Scott NEMA, that nematode, it was going down during this period of the cooling trend, and now it's kind of stabilized. So this is Scott NEMA, and the blue is Urodelimus. And if we look, we can make lines like that. If we look at how the lakes are changing, the volume of the lakes have been going up because of the increased stream flow and primary production. which is shown in green, has reached a low point, and it's been going up as well. So the lakes are becoming more productive. And we can think about how the changes in these other systems and other valleys may influence the system. Here's Taylor Valley, where we have three lakes that aren't connected. They're closed basin lakes. They don't drain to the ocean. We've started studying Lake Mears, which is a flow-through lake, and the Garwood Valley, where there's a stream that discharges right to the lake. To sort of put this in context, the other point I want to make is that this landscape is changing, and potentially we can be thinking about how the climate regime that we are experiencing now, or we think is normal, may eventually move inland if this ozone hole amelioration proceeds and the overall climate warming takes off. But we don't know the pathway here. And so I'd like to end here so there's time for questions. And I want to acknowledge the logistical support, not only UNAVCO, but the PHI helicopter pilots. Raytheon was the lead contractor for a lot of this research, and then ASC at Lockheed Martin, and many of our collaborators. The excellent support makes this kind of research possible. And we've certainly benefited most recently to help to get our telemetry network, mcmltr.org, while you're being cold, feeling cold here in Boulder. Our MET data is being telemetered, and you can look that up on our website. And also the light intensity and like the different lakes and all of that. So thanks to everybody, and I'd be glad to entertain questions.
I was wondering, during the years where you have the higher stream flows, are there any other events that correlate to that, like wind events that might deposit dust onto the glaciers?
We did a lot of study of wind. We looked at wind in the winter, wind in the summer, and weren't able to find any correlation. And the idea that has been published, there's been small areas that have been where the effect of sediment has been studied, and we have observed changes in some of the sediment. The threshold wind speed is, I think, 5 meters per second in terms of moving some of the sediment onto, and the winds have to be high enough, so we use thresholds to try to potentially get a better correlation rather than just wind speed. And we're not able to get a correlation. And the other thing I didn't include in this broader talk is that it's not that temperature doesn't matter in terms of using a temperature index model to look at the changing relative contributions of glaciers at different elevation. A temperature index approach works fine in terms of explaining the greater proportional contribution of the higher elevation glaciers when the summer is warmer. So that kind of model works. It's just that in years when there's an ozone hole, effectively, there's a different yield coefficient to your temperature index model by a factor of 5. It's a lot. Well, it has to be big, because for the lake to rise a meter in 3 weeks, it's a big lake. In fact, you can sort of... the contributing area of the glaciers is maybe 2 or 3 times the surface area of the lake. So, yeah. You need a big change in meltwater contribution per unit area of a limited area in order to, even with a higher adiabatic collapse rate.
That relates to my question. That is, how much, with the ozone hole, do you see a correlation with ice melting in either specific glaciers or on the ice sheets? Have they seen any correlation with the ozone hole there?
I don't have an answer for that. Mike Gusev is starting, and Andrew are starting to look into that. We have measurements from the met stations that allow us to calculate albedo at the site where the met station is. And if we look at that, the albedo hasn't changed very much right at that met station, but that's only one place. And so there's potentially ways to sediment distribution using remote data, QuickBird, and such. Generally, the higher elevation glaciers don't have as much sediment. That's correct? Is that correct? Yeah, and so the sediment isn't going to explain suddenly getting a lot more water off the higher elevation glaciers more than the what you would get just from the, because the adiabatic lapse, you see what I'm saying, anyway. That's a good point, and it would take an integrated approach over the whole contributing area to nail that down.
Any more questions?
Seals. There was a recently deceased leopard seal at Lake Frixel, 7 kilometers inland, this past season. And so the seals that are mummified and the seal that we had an encounter with was a Weddell seal, and there's some crab-eater seals, but a leopard seal is a predator. And why a leopard seal would drag itself that far inland, there's no penguins to eat. And what happens, according to the seal ecologist or animal behavior experts, is some normal for young male teenage seal some portion to leave the colony and head off in one direction or another. I always tell that to fifth graders.